Lord Jesus, we want to be like you, and we need your Holy Spirit to transform us into your image. And one of the things that are striking about you, Lord Jesus, is your humility. Oh, we long for that. We want to be like you, and we want to show that characteristic not only to each other, but also to the world who desperately, desperately needs it. Thank you for human examples of humility. Thank you that we could share a little bit about that now in our groups. And thank you that we can open up your word now and hear directly from you and listen attentively to you. I pray as we open up your word, Lord Jesus, that we would not resist it, that we would be of sound and clear mind, that we would drink deeply from the well of your wisdom this morning as you've given it to us. We praise you for the fact that we have a Bible, that we can read it, that we can teach it, that we can apply it, and that we can learn together. May your name be glorified this morning, Lord Jesus. I pray that you would put some healing balm on our hearts for all the brokenhearted, that you would visit us in a very special way, and that we would have an experience of you as we go through your word. We pray that in your name. Amen. So you guys know that we're busy with a series. The series is called God's World, God's Way. And we say to live God's way in God's world is wisdom. We said this before, but let me say it again. Wisdom is not only knowing, but doing. Wisdom is not only hearing, but applying. Why is it so? Because everything we see, everything we have is His, and God has a will for it. So the best thing we can do is seek wisdom for how to live God's way in God's world. Now, to help us to gain this wisdom and to receive this wisdom, we are studying the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs is a book that we call part of wisdom literature, and it's designed to teach us wisdom. Let me show you again what Proverbs is. I showed this to you last week as well, but just by way of recap. Wisdom is not law. Wisdom is not prophecy. Wisdom is the accumulated insight of God's people through generations. That's what we're reading now. Some people lived before us, they learned some stuff, they wrote it down, and then they say to us, hey, listen, I've been there before, this is how you live. And that's what we are trying to access through this series. Today's theme is humility. Humility. We will speak on humility and specifically study what the book of Proverbs says about this. Now let's start with a ripper of a quote from Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Check this out. Every Christian has a choice between being humble or being humbled. Just sit with that for a bit. Spurgeon tells in one of his books, he tells a story of a young preacher. Now, obviously, he trained many preachers, and he was a phenomenal preacher himself. Tells the story of a preacher who rocked up at the pulpit, full of confidence, saying stuff like, today I'm going to sling it, and I'm going to bring it. Well, he didn't say it back then. They spoke old Elizabethan English, but like translated into our vernacular today. And the guy rocked up, stood on the pulpit, and he had an absolute stinker of a sermon. He preached really poorly. He was all over the place, didn't feel like the sermon landed, and as he came down from the pulpit, he had his head hung low, he was a little bit disheartened, and he just felt really, really sad and needy. And then Spurgeon says what he told the young preacher was, if you went up the way you came down, you would have come down the way you went up. Huh? How's that for wisdom and some reality check? Real talk, fam, I don't profess to be humble, but I want to. I want to be humble. And when I don't want to be humble, I want to be humble. Real talk. And I want to be humble because I believe that Jesus expects it of me. I really do. He was the example of humility. Philippians 2 verse 8 says, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. Jesus did it willingly. And see, it's that willingly that is a real struggle for me. And I don't know about you. Willingly humbling myself. Why do I want to do it? I think that's a fair question. It's because the humble gets God's gaze. Look at Isaiah 66 verse 2. But this is the one to whom I will look. He who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. That's what gets God's attention. That's what he notices. That's something that God is looking for in us, is humility. The humble gets God's gaze. The humble also gets God's grace. Look at James 4 verse 6, but he gives more grace, and therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Look at Peter in 1 Peter 5 verse 5, clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now James and Peter, both of them are quoting Proverbs 3:34. And they are quoting Proverbs 3:34 from the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament called the Septuagint. Right? So the Hebrew scripture was translated into Greek, and then Brother James and Peter are quoting from the Greek. We are going to look at Proverbs 3:34 now in the English translation, which was translated from the Hebrew Bible. So it's going to sound a little bit different, but you will be able to follow along with me. Let's take a closer look at this citation. Look at verse 31 of Proverbs 3. It says, do not envy a man of violence, and do not choose any of his ways. For the devious person is an abomination to the Lord, but the upright are in his confidence. The Lord's curse is on the house of the wicked, but he blesses the dwelling of the righteous. And here's the quote. Toward the scorners he is scornful, but to the humble he gives favor. The wise will inherit honor, but fools get disgrace. If you follow the highlights, you'll see the contrast. And the whole purpose of the contrast is to show us it's either or. Look at it. Devious and an abomination, or upright and in his confidence. Cursed and wicked, or blessed and righteous. Scorned or given favor. Honor or disgrace. That's the whole purpose of the contrast. And that means that we have a choice. It's either the one or the other. You cannot be undecided about pride and humility. You cannot be on the proverbial fence to see how it goes. You have to make a conscious decision if you want to follow the way of humility or the way of pride. See, a proud person is someone who shows himself to be above others. The Greek word for the proud actually comes from two words. And the two words are over and to appear. So to appear over someone else is what a proud person is, according to the Greek New Testament. Someone who disrespects. Someone who despises other believers. That word gets used in the New Testament to talk about arrogant people, disdainful people, or, I like this word, I just don't know how to say it properly, haughty. With an American accent, haughty. With my Afrikaans English accent, haughty. It's a difficult word, but it's a really cool word. This is someone who loves preeminence. So I want to be the best. I want to be first. I want to be the center of attention. This is someone who has an overbearing estimate of his own merit or his own means. Carries a showy pride. That's the proud. Now look what it says about the proud. It says, towards the scorners, he is scornful. That word, also translated as resist, has the meaning of to set oneself against, or to oppose oneself to. Also two Greek words joined into one, against and to arrange. It's a military term. So if you say you resist someone in this sense, the idea is to arrange yourself in battle against. Fam, listen to me. God sets himself in full battle against the proud. God goes to battle with the proud. I don't want that. Do you? I definitely don't want the God of the universe setting himself up for battle against me. No, no, no. I want his gaze. I want his grace. I need both. And I get both through humility. So the way of humility is the way of favorable status, the way of favorable outcome. Favorable status and favorable outcome comes through humility. One question, three answers. Here we go. What do we need to walk in the way of humility? We need the posture of the humble, the perspective of the humble, and we need to know the polar opposite of the humble. Are you guys with me? The posture, perspective, and polar opposite. Let's start with posture. Let's start with Proverbs 16, 18 to 19. Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. It is better to be of a lowly spirit with the poor than to divide the spoils with the proud. Proverbs 29, verse 23. One's pride will bring him low, but he who is lowly in spirit will obtain honor. What is the posture of the humble? The posture of the humble is to be bowed down. The posture of the humble is to get low. Affliction, trials, things that we go through often get us low, doesn't it? And it gets us low and it leaves us without any ability to raise our head and to boast because we've been stripped from the very things that we brag about. Do you guys know that worship is also bowing down? I've said this to you before. You guys saw Chili on his knees this morning. The Greek word for worship is blowing kisses towards or moving towards in this posture and then kissing the feet of the king. That's what worship is. And you do that, and in doing that with your body, you are confessing that I have nothing and I need everything. And you have everything, and therefore I am approaching you humbly. The humble in Proverbs are those who have very little to nothing, and they know it. And they are usually actually not the in crowd. The humble aren't the cool people. The humble are modest people. The humble are restrained people. The humble are listeners before they are loud mouths talking about themselves. The humble lets you have the mic instead of bragging about their own achievements. Do you guys know the experience when you speak and someone finishes your sentences for you? It's devastating. That's not humble at all. Like, you can't even have me finish speak before you need to speak. And if you do that, then, well, look in the mirror. There's a posture to the humble, a posture that says, I really need God. I have a genuine hunger and a thirst for Him. Lowly in spirit is like lowly in fuel. You know when you drive and the fuel light comes on, all of a sudden there's this massive urgency to fill up the tank. Because I can't go with an empty tank, I will get nowhere. How's that true in your spiritual life too? Or do you just ignore the light? I actually know of people that when the light comes on, they take their chewing gum, stick it over the light and pretend like it's not there. If the light comes on, you've got some serious trouble and you need to sort it out. It's the same in our spiritual lives. The lowly in spirit are people who say, my tank is on empty. And I really need you to fill me up. Nothing else will do, and nothing else will satisfy. I've known this before. I am in desperate need of you. Here's an illustration. If I ask you now, what are you currently praying for? What's the answer? Do you know what perplexes me? Is that sometimes on a video call full of Christians, or in a conversation full of Christians, people answer that question with, oh, I'm quite good at the moment. Yeah, I've got no specific prayer requests. What? How is it possible? Oh, it's possible because of pride. Now I'm good. I've got it all under control. I actually don't need anything from God, to be honest. I also don't have anything to say thank you to Him for. I'm good. Can you guys see how pervasive pride is? A prayerless day is a prideful day. And that's the truth. And a prideful day is the opposite of a humble day. So what is your posture? Let me bring you some Martin Luther. God is the God of the humble, the miserable, the afflicted, the oppressed, the desperate, and those who have been brought to nothing. That's us. And if you don't think that that's you, you've got a pride problem. The posture of the humble, lowly in spirit, needy, bowed down. That's what we need to walk in the way of humility. Simple way to say it is, I don't have this. Think about it. Oh, I've got this. The reverse of that is, I don't got this. I know that's not the right English, but it sounds cool. That's the posture of the humble. I don't got this. I don't get up tomorrow morning and go, I am going to nail this day. I get up tomorrow morning and go, I don't got this. I need to get low first, and I need to fill up. Second thing we need, the perspective of the humble. Now, the perspective of the humble could be described as, how do you think about God, and how do you think about others? And that perspective leads to humility. Okay, so the humble acknowledges God's glory and God's character. Character. Here's what the humble say. God is God and we are not. Here's what the humble does. The humble sees God and worships. The humble sees God and worships. Look at Psalm 8. I am going to quote from some other Bible books as well. Psalm 8. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? I'm overwhelmed by what I see, and as I see, I get smaller and you get bigger. That's the perspective of the humble. The humble has another perspective. It's called the fear of the Lord. Look at Proverbs 15:33. The fear of the Lord is instruction in wisdom, and humility comes before honor. Proverbs 22:4. The reward for humility and fear of the Lord is riches and honor and life. Lesego said in the first sermon in the series, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. That is the perspective of the humble. We understand that we have a friend in Jesus, and we understand that Jesus was fully human and fully God. That's true. But we also understand that He is not your friend, like said in a South African proverb way. God is not to be trifled with, fam. He's to be respected. He's to be worshipped. He's holy. He's transcendent. He's bigger than our words could describe. And that fear for Him, a holy fear, is where wisdom starts. And that's where humility comes from. And that's the perspective that the humble has. Do you begin your day by acknowledging Him and your need for Him? Because He's the same, you know, today, than He was yesterday, and than He will be tomorrow. And your need for Him comes from your need for riches and honor and life. You need the things that He has. And the way that you're going to get it is through humility. So that perspective of the humble is crucially important for us. And then not only how we think about God, but also how we think about other people. Look at what Romans 12 and Philippians 2 says. Romans 12 verse 3. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. Or Philippians 2, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Fam, if you want to know what you think about people, then just listen to how you speak about people. And I've said this before. If someone speaks poorly of other people in front of you, they will speak poorly of you in front of other people. Because that's how they roll. There can't be a disconnect between your heart and your mouth. What's in the heart pours out through the mouth. So you can nod at this verse and go, ooh, my word, look, I am nailing this. Always think of others before myself. Really. Can I go through your WhatsApp messages? And see how you speak to others. Because that's the true picture. So the humble has a perspective of God. And the humble has a perspective of himself or herself and other people. And here's what the humble does. The humble acknowledges our limitations. I do not have it all. I cannot do it all. And I am not the best at all. I acknowledge that. And that's the perspective the humble has of him or herself. Now, Xiaomi made a joke about this during question of the day. Let's reframe it in context of the sermon. Humility is not speaking about yourself falsely or negatively. That is false humility. You just broke a world record in the Olympics. Congratulations. Thank you so much. I just want to say I really suck at athletics. I am so poor. I'm the worst athlete in the world. You're not. You're currently the best. See, that's false humility. Because that athlete would be speaking about him or herself in a negative and a false way. Because a record is a record, you know. And you worked for it. Humility is speaking of yourself soberly, truthfully, and holistically. And that means that if you get the record, you say, thank you so much. I appreciate the congratulations. If you're a Christian athlete, I give all glory to God. And then you think of the fact that you are only the best in this one thing you did now. And that's thinking about yourself soberly and truthfully and holistically. I might be a really good 400 meter hurdles athlete, but I am currently a really poor friend and a really poor spouse. And I have a lot of growth in other areas of my life. So, yeah, cheers, thank you. Won't be boasting in this. I still have some way to go. Do you see it? That's what real humility is. Is thinking about yourself soberly, truthfully, and holistically. Tim Keller had this. It's not thinking about yourself. It's not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. You see it? Okay, so real talk. Here comes a question. How do you handle feedback? How do you handle feedback? Because that's a really good mirror for your own pride and your own humility. Because if my feedback to you or about you shows something in a truthful, sober, and holistic way, and you resist it, and you get offended by it, and you want to try and justify it, and you get aggressive about it, and you cancel me for it, then it's clear that your perspective of yourself is not sober, truthful, and holistic. Do you see it? Are you open to instruction? Because if you're not, you need humility. Because the humble is open to that instruction. Because the humble has a perspective of themselves that can handle it. Here's the best perspective you can have about yourself. I'm going to give it to you in Latin because it sounds cool. Martin Luther, Simul justus et peccator. Sounds great, doesn't it? It means simultaneously justified and a sinner. Martin Luther said, that's true of all of us. If you're a Christian, you are simultaneously justified. What a joy. Just as if I died. And you are still a sinner. And that's the paradox that we need to hold. We are significant. We matter. And we are sinful. We suck. At the same time. And if you believe that about yourself, then you can handle feedback. If you believe that about yourself, you are okay to receive instruction. Because if I need feedback and instruction, I go, I am truly still a sinner. Yes, I am. Luckily, that's not my identity because I'm also justified, so that's great news. And I can try again and try again and try again, but I will now humble myself under this instruction and I will admit that I am wrong. Who struggles to say sorry? And all the prideful people in the house go. Because we all have it. In the animation movie Megamind, there's this scene where Megamind speaks and says, you were right, and I was less right. But he just wouldn't say I was wrong. That's pride. You need the perspective of the humble, both of God, of yourself, and of others. So we've spoken about the posture of the humble. We've spoken about the perspective of the humble. Last one. We need to know the polar opposite of the humble. And the polar opposite of the humble is the prideful. Or the proud. Or just the word pride. Remember what I said earlier? A proud person is someone who shows himself to be above others or to appear above others. That is 100% the opposite of humility. 100% the opposite. Pride and humility is similar in no way. It is the complete opposite. And I've said it's either or, and that's why I called it the polar opposite of the humble. Fam, pride is the foundation of sin from which all sin flows. Tim Keller said, it's the sin underneath the sin. So if you contemplate your own sin, and you repent of it, contemplate it, repent of it, and then look for how pride actually led you to this sin. Because it's the foundation of all sin. Think of Genesis 3. God told the humans who they were, and then he said, this is your space, and this is your job, go for gold. Be fruitful and multiply. Enjoy, fam. I shall visit you in the afternoon. Glorious. And what did the people think? I am actually a little bit more important than what God said. And I'm actually a little bit bigger than this space and responsibilities he gave us. Self-exalting, self-exaggerating sin. Boom. That was the struggle of Satan himself. That's how he ended up being who he is. I'm more important than you say I am, and I'm a little bit bigger than the space you've given me. Led to pride, led to sin, and led to eternal damnation. We don't want to be there. And that's exactly what he did with the humans. He had the humans believe that they are bigger and more important than God said they were. So they tried to seize that autonomy and take it from God. Fam, listen to me. We have something in our world called the selfie. My problem with the selfie is the word self. We have the YouTube. You know what my issue is with the YouTube? It's the word you. We have the TikToks, where people are supposed to look at you. Have you ever seen people dancing to TikTok videos? It's crazy. It's like they have a romantic relationship with the camera because I need you to look at my shuffle as I'm going for it. Look at me! Look at me! Is what all our platforms say. I'm telling you now, as your pastor, the world will not help you to be more humble. It will not. And we need to know this. We need to be aware of it. Look at Proverbs 11:2. When pride comes, then comes disgrace. But with the humble is wisdom. Proverbs 16:5. Everyone who is arrogant in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Be assured, he will not go unpunished. Fam, that is the opposite of what I want. And I believe it's the opposite of what we want. Do you want some disgrace? Do you want to be called an abomination to the Lord? Do you want to be punished? Absolutely not. And the scripture says, if you follow the way of pride, that is what you are going to get. We want God to maintain us. We want God to protect us. We want God to sustain us. We want God's strength. Look at this one. Proverbs 15:25. The Lord tears down the house of the proud, but maintains the widow's boundaries. Isn't that beautiful? Someone lowly in spirit, someone in need, someone who in that context had nothing, that's the one who God gives maintenance, protection, and sustenance to. Humble. We want life. We want hope. We want to know that God's goodness in the end will trump all of our circumstances. How do you get that? Once again, you get it through humility. Look at Proverbs 18:10-12. Part of Gizoli Biza, which we sung, is actually a quote of this verse. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. A rich man's wealth is his strong city, and like a high wall in his imagination, before destruction, a man's heart is haughty. But humility comes before honor. Just look at this. The proud are after what is destined and promised to the humble. Do you see it? So we get honor, the humble. We are safe. We are righteous. That gets given to the humble, but that is actually what prideful people are after. So in your pride, you build your wealth, and in your wealth, you think, I have made it. I now have everything I need for safety and for honor. And then Proverbs says, destruction will follow. It's like the great reversal. Do you see it? The one who has everything will end up with nothing. The one who seems to have nothing will end up with everything. That's biblical wisdom. Which one do you want? Which one do you want? Do you want honor or do you want destruction? Because from the book of Proverbs, it's clear to us that we have to choose one or the other. Do you guys know what I want? I want Isaiah 57:15. Look at this amazing verse. For thus says the one who is high and lifted up, that's the perspective of the humble, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, check this, I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with him who is of a contrite and lowly spirit. To revive the spirit of the lowly, and to revive the heart of the contrite. Isn't that beautiful? That's what I want. I want this almighty, omniscient God to dwell with me, and as he dwells with me, I want him to revive me. Revive my spirit and revive my heart. Huh? It's like rocking up at the garage and going, full tank, please, my man. And then they go, first click, and then you go, no, 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 all the way, my man. Huh? Nothing like turning on the ignition and seeing that needle go above the F. That's reviving. That's refreshing right in there. That's what I want for my heart. And that's what I want for my spirit. And the Bible makes it clear that I won't get it if I'm proud and haughty. I'll get exactly the opposite. Let's turn our attention to Jesus. Luke 14, verse 7-11. This is Jesus speaking. While Luke writing and then quoting Jesus as he spoke. Now he told a parable to those who were invited, when he noticed how they chose the places of honor, saying to them, "When you are invited by someone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in a place of honor, lest someone more distinguished than you be invited by him. And he who invited you both will come and say to you, 'Give your place to this person,' and then you will begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit in the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, 'Friend, move up higher.' Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, says Jesus, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." Now, this is one of those times in the Bible where I believe that Jesus cannot be more clear than he is. Right? Other times we have to work for the meaning. This time it's really clear. Everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. And he who humbles himself will be exalted. Remember, Jesus knew the entirety of the Hebrew Scriptures off by heart. Think of the temptation of Jesus as it's accounted to us in the Gospels. He was tempted with pride. And he resisted with humility. I know that he answered with scriptures in mind, but every time those scriptures had to do with humility. Jesus goes on, Mark 10:45. He says, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Do you see how Jesus knows the posture of the humble? How Jesus has the perspective of the humble? How Jesus is the polar opposite of the prideful, meaning that he is humble? He said, "It's not about me." And I mean, if there was one human being who could have said, "It is actually all about me," it was him. I mean, I say it. The whole Bible is a unified story that leads to Jesus. Jesus is the big deal. We are a gospel-centered church. Jesus on earth says, "It's not about me. It's about you and about me paying a ransom for you so that you can be saved." We get this amazing picture of Jesus in John 13 at a table, the kind of table where he told his disciples earlier in the Gospel of Luke, "Don't sit at the place of honor." And he gets up. He sees their feet are dirty because they might have slipped it out of their Jerusalem cruiser sandals. Takes off his tunic, in his vesey, gets some water, gets down on his knees, and does the work that a slave does, and that is wash the feet of his disciples. And here's the crazy thing. After that whole interaction between Jesus and his disciples, he says to them, "You have seen me do this. Now you should go and do the same to others." That's Jesus. Jesus humbled himself even to the point of death on a cross. Why? Because he knew that he had to suffer as a substitute for our salvation. Someone had to pay for our sin. It had to be a payment that satisfied God's wrath. We call that payment a propitiation, and he paid it. And now we are saved. So when we then repent, we receive his forgiveness, and we keep on remembering it daily because we still don't have to pay for it. We've said at this church many times, God gives us the gift of faith, and we receive that gift of faith, and we grab that gift of faith by taking a leap of faith. We say you admit your sins, you believe in Jesus, and you confess him as your Lord and Savior. All because he made it so easy for us. And why? Because of his humility. Because of his service, because of his willingness to think of the other and not of himself. Jesus was submitted to the mission the Father had for him. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says continuously, "I only came to do what the Father sent me to do. So what I'm saying is what the Father tells me to say, and what I'm doing is what the Father tells me to do. That's all I'm here for." He was humble believing that honor will come after his humility. And this is what makes him such a compelling character to everyone, believer and non-believer alike, is the fact that Jesus risks it for the biscuit. If you guys have heard that one, eh? Look, I actually got to risk it for the biscuit. Jesus knew that he would get the highest glory and honor, but through the way of humility, and he went for it. Look at what Philippians 2 verse 9 says. Therefore, God has exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name. Glory was Jesus's, honor is Jesus's after the cross. Do you see it? Humility, submission, and suffering first, and then honor and glory. Fam, this is the very image we are being transformed to. This is the one whose example we follow. Do you guys realize that? We will not get or have everything we so desperately want in this life, but after humility, after suffering, after submission, after service, after washing feet, we will get it all. And we have to choose for that. We have to choose for that. And every time this world we live in shows us a picture of someone who seemingly has it all, we have to resist it. Because that picture is a difficult one to deal with. Because I choose the way of submission and service and humility. But then this person's life looks so awesome. Can't I just have this? And then the Spirit of the Lord says, you will get infinitely more than that. But get low and stay low. Because glory and honor will come. Glory and honor will come. How do we respond to this text and to this word? Let me offer three responses. So we spoke about the posture, the perspective, and the polar opposite. I think here's a way that you can respond. The one is to get low. So if your position is not a position of need, is not a position of emptiness, is not a position of nothingness, then you are invited today to enter into that position and to lay down the so-called things you think you have and to say to God, I come to you actually with nothing. Because all I have is yours anyway, you know. It's not like I can come to you and go, hey God, look at this awesome thing I achieved because you gave it to me in the first place. Maybe that's something that you are invited into. Look, I understand during worship, not all of us are super expressive with our bodies. But I do want to invite you, though, that just dropping the head can actually make a big difference in your posture, you know. Just opening up your hands and receiving what it is from God. Or just exalting Him by surrendering with a posture like this can make the world's difference. I don't always know how your body responds to your words that you sing if you stand like this. I don't know. I don't even cross my hands like this when I listen to someone speaking to me because it feels like I'm shutting you out. Maybe just try that today. I don't know how you pray at home, but I've showed this to you before. Exhibit A, check this. Kneeling like this is hardcore. Your patella will not make it. But God has given us more postures than that. Watch this. On the elbows, boom, boom. Guys, you can stand like this for hours. It doesn't do anything to your patella. It will stiffen your neck, though, if you look left and right. So there's really only one place where you can look, and that's down. When was the last time you actually knelt in prayer? It will make you humble. Another response is to say, God, I do not think biblical thoughts of you. I don't think truthful thoughts of you. I think emotional thoughts of you. I think false thoughts of you. I've made you to be someone or something that responds to my feelings. I want to see you for all you are and in all your glory. Or maybe your perspective towards people need to change. Maybe you really, really dislike people. And maybe you really think that all people suck, but you're awesome. Maybe that's something that you need to bring to God today and go, God, just Just give me a new perspective here. Give me some new lenses. Clean my eyes from the stuff that's making my perspective of you and others murky. I need you to do that in me. Or maybe today is just a calling or a response to solid repentance. Say, God, I have followed the way of the proud. And that's going to lead to destruction. That will not go unpunished. I am turning, and I wish to follow the way of the humble. I need you. I'm desperate for you. Lead me in this way. Maybe that's your response. If you resonate with any of these three, let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, these words cut really, really deep. And it's difficult to do. And when we get it right, we know that it leads to life. And when we get it wrong, we know that it leads to destruction. But it feels like a never-ending fight between pride and humility. But Lord Jesus, we hear your words. You gave us clear instruction. And you gave us an awesome example. And that example not only led to honor and life for you, but it led to life for us and will lead to honor for us. And that just makes us following you in the way of humility even more compelling. So Lord Jesus, I pray that you bring us low. That you would amplify the need we have for you in our hearts. I pray that you would open up our eyes to see you for who you really are and to see others for who they really are. And I pray that you would receive us as your children if we repent today of our pride, if we turn around and run to you. Oh, thank you that we will only get a loving Father. Dancing about us, smiling about us, knowing all of our ins and outs, embracing us, and saying to us that you don't even think about our sins anymore. We can do it again. And we have another chance with you. Make us humble, Lord Jesus, all for the glory of your name. Amen.